Yes, good evening, everyone.
Hello, everyone.
So we hope we
are audible, correct?
Yes, we are.
And by the look of your comments, we can see your patience going down like our stock market.
Yes,
we can see that.
So finally, today we had what, 250 points correction in Nifty, almost 1000 points correction in Sensex. And the reason which started is what today's discussion is all about. Right.
Yes. So today we are going to talk about what the so-called, so the media and everyone is so exuberant about this. They have called this entire thing as the next lemon crisis.
Right? Yes.
Indian lemon
crisis.
Is this like 2008?
Everyone so is talking
someone,
about that.
Someone is also saying repeat of Satyam crisis and all
repeat
that.
Repeat of 2008, doomsday story and everything.
So they are out there to scare everyone.
So this is a good time to remember each and every crisis that has gone down.
That's a good time, correct?
Yes, it's a good time.
But in reality, literally, after the IL&FS thing, market has corrected. And it has corrected very nicely, correct? It has corrected
nicely.
Very, yes, very nicely. Depending on your positions, it has corrected very nicely.
True. So correct? What do you mean by nicely?
Yeah.
Very smooth. Very smooth.
Yeah. Very smooth.
Yeah. Just one direction.
One direction. Yeah, that's it. Okay. But the thing is, why we are here today to discuss about that point which has created, which has explicitly, okay, on the surface of it, the IL&FS and BHFL thing, it has created the entire fall on the surface of it. On the surface.
Janak, do you like, it has created a fall, but do you think that is the reason why market is falling?
Actually, the reason is link to that for sure.
You need some trigger. You need some trigger.
It's a scare. It's a scare. People are scared.
That's it.
And on TV also, if you see during the market, there's this one person who comes and actually says that, "Boss, people are scared. Nobody's gonna buy. Go short."
Correct.
So this is the first time I've been impressed with TV.
First time. Okay, we will record this and we will put in our YouTube.
Like, but yesterday they were going buy.
No. He's talking about
one dude. Today also that guy was going buy the other guy. Yeah.
So the false line, the fractious lines were there since last 4-6 months. But this was the point when everything culminated nicely for short sellers. So what was that point? It was all about
So NBFCs, that is what it's all about, and that is what this presentation is also going to be about.
So can we just explain the flow of today's discussion, how we are going to go about it?
So today we are going to go about is, first of all, we'll tell you, like, NBFCs is a talk of the town. So earlier there were rise about NBFCs, what happened in NBFCs, why they were the preferred asset class of investment.
The rise.
Let's put it nicely, dude.
Okay.
So,
the rise
you
and
know
rise.
The downfall, you need to understand the rise and the rise of
so
NBFC.
So, all these names are coming from here.
Yes.
So, these names are coming from here.
So, rise and rise of NBFCs. Why they were there, we will talk about their reasons.
Yes.
Correct? Then we will talk about our inflection point.
Yes, our
that
inflection
is,
point is... It will
IL&FS
starting
story.
With IL&FS story, and then what after that?
Yes.
Spillover. So there are these three parts which we'll try to connect with.
Correct.
So
nowadays markets and financial markets are so interlinked that whenever there is a scare or whenever there is a deep threatening crisis in a single sector or a single domain, it will always get a spillover effect. Be it 2008 from financial market to real economy,
correct.
Be it PSQ bank to all the financial sector, or be it
right now
from NBFC sector to entire market or entire financial system. Correct.
So
let's start
the presentation. Just a second. So to start, as we spoke about rise and rise of the NBFCs, what we want to showcase about, like, how these stocks were considered to be, like, if I remember Rahul, earlier, like few months back, if I talk to anyone which stock to consider for buying, they would always come and recommend me and tell me that, okay, boss, housing finance companies are the best companies to invest in right now. Then they'll think about NBFCs, and that was the talk of the town, if you remember, 3 to 4 months
yes.
down the line.
So to prove that, so we cannot, no, we don't have to blame them, but yes, why they were telling like that, just have a look at few charts, correct?
Right?
NBFC chart.
Right.
So stocks were rising like hell in 2018.
Right.
They were getting huge amount of valuation. They are raising, so NBFCs, okay? NBFCs, they earn on the basis of money, correct?
Right, right,
they raise money, correct? They borrow money and they lend money. They give the loans. And then they get the net interest margin and they earn profits.
Right.
So they were, so Divan Housing, VHFL, let's start with the culprit, dude.
Let's start with the best.
Let's start with the best. Sarcasm, dude.
Best?
Okay.
Come on.
Earlier best.
Best performer.
Best performer.
I think this one was one of the best.
So within a year.
And so was I too.
Yes.
So within a, like, in the chart, we'll see it took how much time to reach that point, and it was just one day that it took for it to fall.
So what we'll do monthly chart, and for a time being, for the sake of our story, we will hide this. Correct, we will hide this. And
you cannot hide it, buddy.
Okay,
it is all there.
Okay, no problem. So have a look at this.
So it took the stock, like if you see from here.
Yeah, let's do it from here.
2016, okay. This is the talk of the
Jan
town.
Jan 17.
It took 237 to 600. Okay. 680.
Wow.
Okay. From Jan 17 to what was the date? 18. August 18.
18.
Correct. Let's take a different. Let's go to Gruha.
Gruha Finance.
Again. So this was December. This is Jan. Jan it was
158. It went to 400. I think it touched 370.
370. Let's go to Repco.
Repco Finance. Repco Home. Yeah.
Repco was okayish. Okay, Repco was okayish.
Yeah, but even if you see,
no, that's 13, I guess. Let's forget about 13. Uh-huh. Let's go to this up now. HDFC, the biggest of the lot, dude.
Oh yeah, HDFC grew.
Bajaj Finance is there. Bajaj Finserv is there.
HDFC from 1231.
Yes,
it went to
high of 2000. Let's go to Bajaj Finance.
It's a large cap stock, so. This is auto related again from here, Jan 2017, 868 almost touched 3000.
Bajaj Finserv. Apne paas kami nahi hai.
So 3000 it touched 7000.
So all in all,
yes,
all the stocks.
So just show them the volume. One of them is saying, please, volume.
Volume? Right.
Volume?
Done.
Wow.
Someone asked, can you show the volume?
Volume.
Yeah, it's there.
Volume is there. Okay.
So the thing, the guy is, it's not like that. Okay.
So
first
if you
of
see,
all,
there is a jump in the volume. So if you want to.
So guys, first of all, there is a caution.
Hmm.
Stop looking at this meteoric rises as frauds or correct.
Yeah.
Stop looking at these things like that. This is not a fraud. This is a common common phenomenon. So
in stock market, like I would like to relate them. If you talk about Bitcoins, this was a phenomena few months back. Everybody was talking about Bitcoin.
Right.
And then finally there was a crash. So that is also something which happened with all the stocks before a fall. They are at the peak of their
optimism.
Good
at
one.
The final leg of
correct.
Their rally.
Correct. And
euphoria.
Guys, why this thing happened? Let's talk about that. Why all the NBFC sector, be it housing finance or normal NBFC, why they got this kind of valuation? Why they were at epitome?
Valuation.
Why they, not valuation means, yeah, we will talk about that.
Yeah.
Why they were raising money at so high valuations? So let's talk about that first, okay? So the stage, okay. So the eye candies, they were the eye candies of the
town. Yes.
Nation, correct? Not nation and town, FIIs even.
Look at group finance.
So this is price to book. So in Jan 18, SDFC 6.7, group 15.17, Bajaj 6.6. So to compare this, let me tell you guys at what price to book PSUs are trading.
0.3.
Okay, 0.3 to 0.5.
And 0.5.
That was the reason NBFC got that initial jet fuel to propel. Right. Correct? Why? This all is, the stage was set.
Engineering language. Yes, jet fuel.
Jet fuel to propel.
Jet, by the way.
Jet did good at today.
It's a different story. Today.
Jet is a different story.
So, stage was set for NBFCs. Correct? The greatest problem was, the greatest good thing was, and problem is inside that. Okay? The greatest good thing was, due to our economic rise, okay, disposable income was increasing and the urbanization was increasing. People were ready to get mortgage, take mortgage.
Affordable housing scheme.
Correct.
N number of things.
The latent demand was there for credit. Everything was there. People, they wanted money for car, for phone. For, yes, thanks to Apple. Thanks to Apple. No, ghar bar is one thing, dude. Now we take a loan for phones.
Flipkart will offer you a loan for to anything. Buy an iron of 500 bucks also.
Correct. Yes. So I there mean, was a latent credit demand. But the problem was that due to PSUs and their stress tested, they didn't have that ability to provide loan to everybody. Apart from that, all these banking sectors, they have norms. Correct. They do not lend to few sectors or few sections like startups. They cannot lend to startups. This is just an example. Rural areas, correct? If there is no asset, PSU banks, okay, apart from the biggies.
IL&FS can invest in startups.
Correct. Even from biggies. Let's not go over there. This is a rise and rise thing. Okay. So apart from, for few sectors where banking sector cannot lend, these guys were there. As it is, and this upcoming demand, PSUs and bankings, they were unable to fulfill that credit demand. That's why STH was set up for NBFCs, because most of these NBFCs, they have a proper target area. They have a proper business model. Okay, I'll go for finance, housing finance only. I'll do the vehicles only. I'll do the consumer durables only. Right. Okay, they started with that.
That's
model.
How they started off.
That model, correct.
But the eventuality of it was that the Muthoot gold loan guy now offers loan on other things.
Correct. Annapuram is also offering other things.
Everyone now offers everything.
Agreed. So, but while these guys were performing good, nobody was resisting them.
No one was.
No one was like they are expanding. Correct. Now we are looking at that like a business flaw. But at that time they were like we are expanding now. Correct.
So that is always the case with whenever there is a crisis, they go on expansion like anything, and then they finally realize that boss, hum log ne kuch had se zyada hi aage badh liye hai, abhi problem ho gaya.
And
you name any company that has fallen, that has gone for a default or has declared itself bankrupt, their major problem is they go on expanding without thinking.
Board,
So this NBFC thing, they were in a euphoric zone before that, correct? NBFC thing, they were in a completely euphoric zone before that. And the guy is, so business was doing good. Everything was booming, correct? So there was a demand, some NBFC were there. The boss, loan lelo, demand loan lelo, demand loan lelo. So they were growing their their AUM was growing. Have a look at this. DHFL has 1,21,000 crore ka loan book.
And
1,21,000 crore ka loan book. HDFC has 4,19,000 crore ka loan book. Grow Finance is a small one, but a tight one. So 16, it's a tight one. Good stock. 16,000 crore loan book. Ibul Housing Finance, 1,25,000 crore ka loan book. This guy, they have achieved this in last few years.
Yes.
Think about the latent demand which was there, correct? Banking system was failing. These guys were filling the gap.
Yeah.
And because of this huge growth, now think about stock market. As it is, PSU banks were there not doing good.
That sounds so noble, right?
And
banks are not giving you a loan, so I'll give you a loan.
Plus,
that happens every time, dude.
Yeah.
RBI was like more reasonable on NBFCs and giving out licenses as
well. Earlier, there were less regulations also. Yes. But now they have, by looking at their growth, they started regulating after, I think, 15 stricter regulations.
On that note, Ram Nivas was asking, what is the role of RBI in this crisis?
Yeah, we will talk about that. So we are currently looking at the creation of a hero.
DSFL.
Stay long enough to see your hero to become a villain. So, okay, Ram. So stay with us for 30 minutes. Okay.
So Rahul, do you want to talk about DHFL over here? Like DHFL's asset under, like, it was the one which you're talking about, 1 to 1 billion. So if you go in the market and ask about who will give you loan, home loan, if your home is 20 years even old, if your home is has no guarantee left, the one person that will give you a home loan is DHFL.
Yes.
Okay, normally banks or NBFCs have a strict norm that, okay, boss, the homes are beyond 20 years, we should not give you a loan because my returns or the money that is there, it is riskier asset for
correct,
me.
Correct.
But that is not the case. If you do your ground level research on this front, DHFL gaav duniya ko loan deta hai.
Yeah, DHFL is like the banker to the unbanked. Lender to the unlended.
Sound noble, dude. Again.
Yeah, sounds very noble.
But
like,
not in
yeah.
the framework of business.
So, let's say you're a dhobi and you don't have much of a income tax return that you file. And then you buy some kind of a small house somewhere and you want a loan. DHFL will definitely give
yes.
you a loan.
Now, at this point, nothing about that profession, but it's all about your soundness of your business.
Of
correct?
Course, of course. Nothing against the profession.
So, yes.
My point is that small entrepreneurs, banks do not touch them. Okay.
That is.
Banks cannot give you a loan if you're not a salaried person. End of story. So then these NBFCs come up. That also these big sophisticated NBFCs again will not touch you. But then there is DHFL and there are a couple of other ones which are risky,
yes.
Which like to take that kind of risk, Reliance being one of them. They will give loans to anyone if they feel that that person is good enough to repay.
Correct. And earlier we discussed the retail side of it. Now you have discussed the corporate side of
corporate
it.
Side
correct.
Of it, right.
How they have disbursed the loan. But this thing is called as rat race. Now
right.
everyone is growing. So these NBFCs, like you mentioned, Ritesh and Janak, that now they are just looking for a buyer of a loan. That's it.
Any yes. loan.
Any loan. And
so
because
why,
of rise of SMEs also.
Janak rightly said, na, loan le lo.
Loan le lo. Correct. So rise of this, where that SMEs also, the entrepreneurs, the SME guys, rise of that segment also created demand for NBFCs. And that created rat race. Like rat race in 2008, I'm not comparing again two crises, but kind of that. Again, they were raising more money. They were altering business
models.
They were altering
ticket size
even.
Yes.
That earlier, like I'll only give loans about 10 crore. Now they are ready to give smaller loans
now,
also.
They'll give you a loan for an iron.
They are ready to do that.
Yeah.
Correct. They are going out in market. They are issuing through rights issue, through IPOs. They are raising money. And that is called as a rat race. Okay. And that's why, because of all these good pointers, all these NBFCs, they were experiencing huge amount of goodwill, benefit and valuations.
So I want to show one link which Economic Times published in April. Okay, if you can just open Google and type housing finance firms are a big story. You'll find this first link by Economic Times.
Like first thing.
Right. And now look at the lovely lines this fellow has written on 19th April. It's like a love letter. Yeah. Housing finance companies never had it so good. Supportive policy framework, more disposable income are creating a perfect mix for them. The segment has already brought out many multi-baggers over the past 5 to 10 years. And investors are in a state of
Oh.
Yeah. Except some private lenders, housing finance companies have delivered far superior returns compared to banks. For instance, Dewan Housing Finance jumped over 550% during last 5 years, all that. Go down. There's one particular line which this guy moved. Go down. Even housing loans are in the pink of health. Can you highlight? Even housing loans are in the pink of health. So my point is what? That when something goes into that euphoria stage, which Ritesh was talking about in the start, okay? These kind of absurd articles will come about in your Economic Times, where people start romanticizing sectors. That should be your clue that there is something wrong going on here. There is something absolutely wrong that is going on in this sector.
And vice versa as well. Like if they come up with an equally negative article on something, that is the right time to buy that particular sector.
At least start looking at it, if yeah, not buy.
Start looking at
so, how it goes is you have to try to find the other end of the story. This is one end of the story where housing loans are in the pink of health. And shares have... Anit says this is the first public love letter.
So, but Janak, we cannot blame him now, correct? His job is to write an article. He's seeing the housing finance going from 200 to 800, correct? And after that, rest is history. This is his love letter. But the thing is, we are not bashing him. We are telling you guys how to identify as there is something euphoric is going on.
Yeah.
Correct? The language like this, the earlier one, when he showed us the returns, that point was perfect. But in the latter part, correct, or like investor are in a state of awe, the pink health, the all these things, unnecessary.
Analysts give a big thumbs up to HFCs considering the promise the sector shows. Yes.
So there are such clues now you will keep coming across in your everyday newspaper that what are they trying to do? And look at the company summary. Can you highlight this?
Like, look at over here.
Yeah.
This is current state.
It shows the current status of. There's expand to view all also. Pink of. It's actually pink.
Wow.
Reddish pink.
Goodness. Wow. Oh. Deep love.
Yeah, this guy turned out to be like a true guy. Anyways, moving on. Jokes apart. So now, this was the euphoric rise of NBFCs. The rise and rise of NBFCs. Now, after this comes the part where we talk about the IL&FS story.
So, the IL&FS story. Just a second. Yes. The IL&FS story. So, most of y'all would be considering how come IL&FS is actually related to NBFCs? That is the first question most of y'all would have in mind. Like if IL&FS has defaulted, how that has related to NBFCs? We'll cover that point. But first of all, let me tell you what exactly is IL&FS. IL&FS is Munna Bhai.
Oh. Wow. So you have chosen to be a dramatic at the start.
Yes.
Okay. Things are going to be good.
So so why Munna Bhai? Because it is supposed to be an investment firm which takes deposits from public and then like the NBFCs work. But what does IL&FS do is it takes government projects as of now. It takes government projects and then makes government a 50-50% partnership over there. And then government ko bolti hai ki, thank you, your job is done. I am taking over this project. I am the one Munna Bhai over here. मैं जो बोलूंगा वो होगा
वसूली भाई
यस सो विद दिस व्हाट इट डज इज इट टेक्स अ लॉट ऑफ फीस फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट बिकॉज़ मैं सब कुछ कर रहा है तू सिर्फ बैठेगा ठीक है इट विल टेक अ लॉट ऑफ फीस आई विल शो यू अ केस स्टडी ऑन दैट एज वेल द गिफ्ट केस स्टडी सो इट डज लाइक दैट एंड विद दैट सो नाउ लेट मी शेयर द स्क्रीन
सो इन दिस सेगमेंट वी विल डिस्कस IL&FS, what it does,
right,
and then where things turned around. Right.
So IL&FS, what I mentioned is as a Munna Bhai, and so at this point of time, I want to take into consideration something called as, just a second. So I have in my presentation, gold-plated management contract. So have you heard this word called gold-plated management contract?
Gold-plated management contract.
Okay.
Money is written all over it.
So if you can, guys, Google it, just Google it if you want to. What is gold-plated management contract? So it's an illegal term, gold-plated management contract. So what happens is, you take the contract, you don't have anything, but you rule the contract the way you want to, you make it in your favor. So it's a management contract, but you are the owner, you are the one deciding everything about it, and there is no role of the other party over there. So this is what it does. So I'll tell you one case study, and then you can relate the rest of the case studies. So this is one case study which I want to talk about. So most of y'all have heard about this Gift City, right? Gift City. So Gift City is a big gift that our government has given to IL&FS. Okay, why I'm saying it is a gift? You'll be wondering why this is a gift, right? Yes, so Gift, okay. So this is something which started in 2015. There was DC Anjaria was the person who conceptualized it. He had a vision of Gift City.
Okay.
And he's the person who filed a PIL.
Okay.
He was removed from that particular. Let me tell you what are the facts that he had mentioned in the PIL. So he has mentioned that Gift City is a government project. I hope you agree with that.
Who means it's in the common notion, Gift is a government project.
It's a government project.
Gift to the public.
So Gift is a government project. So being a government project, government then came up with a PPP model.
Yeah, right. I love this model. Public-private partnership.
Public-private partnership model. And they brought in IL&FS for this.
Wow.
So IL&FS does not primarily has the expertise about this, but they were brought in as a 50-50 joint venture. So by taking in as a joint venture, they had a lot of gifts to give them. So that is why I think this is called Gift.
Oh.
So first gift was, boss, you will have 880 acre of land. Okay. And the rent leasing part will be 1 rupee per acre.
Oh, wow.
Per acre.
880 rupees.
Guys, these are the
for next 20 years.
These are well documented facts because this is from PIL, correct?
Yes. PIL. These are the statements that are taken from the PIL. Then it will be like this is a 5 crore. They had a partnership.
880 acre for 1 rupee per acre. So suddenly I have realized the enormity of it. That's why I'm repeating it.
My train pass is 880 rupees.
Wow.
Per month.
And this is for 20 years, correct?
Yes, 20 years.
Okay.
And then they have to like, they may, IL&FS had to pay 2.5 crore and they were a part of this project. This project was under two companies. The company's shareholding had 5 crore. Out of that, 2.5 crore was government and 2.5 crore was IL&FS. Okay, so of this project.
Wow.
Okay, and with this, they get this land. Okay, this land is practically theirs. Now, being a part, now what does IL&FS do? Boss, I am the one who's an expert over here. You be at the side stage, government, please stay away. You are just an executive chairman, non-executive chairman. Okay, I'll be the one Munna Bhai over here.
Correct.
So I need consultation fees.
Everything.
I need project management fees. So 20 lakh rupees per month as a project management fees is paid. And this is exclusive of taxes.
Oh, no taxes.
Wow.
So this is just a tip of it.
Correct.
Rupees 400 crore.
Rupees 400 crore
as IL&FS consultant fees. So that is what they get for consulting the government what to do with the Gift City.
Perfect. Wow.
Okay. Then what happened is this project was for 20,000 crore.
Okay.
In 2008, IL&FS said that this is not a 20,000 crore, this is a 70,000 crore project, and I want 1% success fees for this.
Success fees.
So,
completion is it a success?
Completion fees, correct.
Before completion, they want success fees.
Okay. Oh, okay.
So they said, okay, le le, 700 crore aur le le.
If you will make the project successful, we'll 700 crore.
Yeah. Wow. So the last thing is where this all controversy started, where they made 400 crore for architectural and engineering to Fairwood Consultancy. So Fairwood Consultancy is primarily IL&FS ka chota bhai, jo uske Noida toll bridge ke company ke office mein ek chota sa office hai uska.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And that in that there was stipulated that once I receive the fees in advance, even if I don't deliver the service, I am not liable to pay back to you.
So
in that contract, it has written.
And this is stated by this guy in PI.
No, no, this right? He is not. This is a different story.
But this is stated in the PI.
Dr. Anjaria in the PI.
PI, he stated
this.
Okay, then.
Okay.
So we are not from this, the horse's mouth.
This guy over here is Mr. Pandey.
Oh, IL&FS.
He is gift current chief.
Correct.
Okay, so what he did was, since IL&FS is Munna Bhai over here, right, so see, IL&FS is Munna Bhai. So he came out with an advertorial on Business Standard. This is an advertorial on Business Standard. Allegation, not given any statements related to that, and all these things are there. So this is what is a particular business which IL&FS works. Okay.
Way of their thought process of
yes,
how
this
they,
is one yeah. example.
It's gold plated.
It's gold plated,
yeah. gold-plated yeah. management contract. Okay, I want to showcase on few of their. This is I have taken from their annual report. So, IL&FS Transport gets two orders for worth 4,700 from NHIA. Okay, these are the orders. If you remember Noida toll expressway from Supreme Court right now, it has been said that you cannot collect any taxes. Because there are two PILs on that particular Noida toll. So even Noida toll is part of ILHF. And one more thing that if you see, you have taken from this annual report, these are the projects that they have taken. So Noida toll is one of them. Look at the number of projects that they have. This is just IL&FS Transport. I have not gone to the other two companies that they have.
And Transport being the best company ever.
So look at the number of contracts that they have got.
It went up 35% in 2 days.
Okay. And someone is getting, I mean, this company is getting bailout. That is also something which we want to question. So these are the number of contracts that they are getting. Okay. Plus this gift city is one of that thing that they are also getting over here. And it's all started when auditors of this company issued some red flags. In their report. So their quarterly results are out and there were some red flags which were issued. You can see that red flags over here. They have mentioned that because of that they might have gone, their credit ratings have suffered because of that. All this has started after that. So this is what IL&FS does. It takes a government project, 50-50% ownership, and with this 50-50% ownership, it goes to a bank. Primarily, it has to be a public sector bank. Boss, it's a government project, so government will fund from private sector bank. They get their debt, and with that debt, they also charge the government with various fees, that I want this fees, that fees, and with that fees, they become the owner. So that fees is the part of their capital which they pay, and that is how they work. So this is about IL&FS. Like, I think, okay, if you go and search about the person who has filed for this PIL, Dr.
DC Anjaria,
you'll get this PIL. So I hope I answered your question, Siddharth.
Okay.
Okay. So this is about IL&FS. And by the way, Janak, you were going to show something about these IL&FS bonds, which are taken as a debt from public. And I already told you what is the business model. Okay. These are AAA bonds, Janak.
Yeah, so in March, they were AAA bonds, okay? And then in August, they reduced the rating to A. Yeah, in August, they reduced the rating to A. And in September, they made it double B. And in 10 days after that, they made it D. Yeah, I've never seen bonds getting revised every 10 days. But I've got a few reports to show you.
Before that, General, so AAA, the AAA rated bonds, So if you see IL&FS history, then you will come across various cautions, various warnings from, let's say, RBI. So there are news that in 2008, okay, RBI, it has warned IL&FS, correct? 3 years back, RBI came forward again and warned IL&FS about its business and credit cycle and everything.
It
correct?
Mentioned
even
that
after that,
RBI came once and it mentioned that, boss, your loan debt is too high. Please reduce the debt. Okay, and their debt is really too high.
Correct. And still, the question is, okay, so just few months before, it was AAA, correct? The real question is, if a system or organization like RBI, it is repeatedly coming forward and it is talking about a particular specifying, correct, a particular company's debt problems, then still these credit rating agencies, they are giving their persistent to give AAA to that company is questionable. Is
so
we are not like,
I will show you the language they use for that.
I have one more
We are not bash mongers that we are bashing credit rating agencies.
There is one person,
correct,
who is defending this. They are saying that this is a government project, so government will always come to bail out, and that is why we are giving AAA ratings. That is what they are saying.
Agreed. But the question is, the right answer, the counter to that person's thing is that once you do a bond AAA, it is eligible for
safest,
and more than that, it is ever eligible for accumulation
lower
and investment for various funds.
Correct.
Be it mutual fund, be it, that means by making bond AAA, you are spreading that bond into your financial systems.
Yes.
So the credit ratings problem was RBI ne bola ki bhai problem hai, then they are making AAA. That means they are inherently creating the fractured lines within the financial system by doing
see
that.
This is a fractured line.
Yes. And now Janak, you want to share something, correct? The level of language.
Yeah. So I have three reports of ICRA. Okay. The rational reports. And first I want to open the market.
Okay,
yeah, this is the March one.
So sorry. I should have opened it on.
This orange screen will come.
Pink love.
Oh, on Chrome, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is the March one where they have rated their commercial paper program.
Program.
Dear Lord. So they have rated the commercial paper program as A1+. Okay, now in their rating system for short term papers, short term debt, A1+ is like the most stable bond that you can have. Okay, and for long term, AAA is the most stable one that you can have. So this is the respective ratings that they have given to this bond in March, as on 27 March. Okay. Now, there's a reason why they did that, which they have mentioned.
Okay.
All right.
Open this.
Okay, now if you scroll down, you'll see the reason. The rationale is some crap. Let's go down. Yeah. So these are the key rating drivers or credit strength. Why is it good? One is established brand in infrastructure development with a long track record, strong and competent management. Yeah. Okay, this is a rationale why it should be given. Sher Khan decided to. Yeah.
US decided to.
Yeah, Fat Khan decided to. Yeah. Anyways, so second is strong institutional shareholders, both domestic and institutional, right? Now, here they have given a brief history that IL&FS was promoted by Central Bank and HDFC and Unit Trust of India.
But HDFC actually got out from it way before.
Right. And then, yeah, that's mentioned
Unit
here.
Trust India then became LIC.
Right. And a lot of people have changed hands of this. Everyone has tried to milk this cow, it seems. Okay. But all these institutions are shareholders.
They are transferring the hot potato.
Are they milking the cow or they are transferring the hot potato?
Wow. Yeah, that puts a whole new light on it.
LIC actually got default setting. LIC, like it was with UTI, and UTI specific undertaking of UTI, Unit Trust of India, and LIC got the shares as UTI was not existent, and that
was the share, dehej mein aa gaya types. Yeah, absolutely. So the next one, now this is the important one that I want you to focus, is that focus of the company to build and maintain contingency reserves to cushion against asset quality issues.
Wow.
And it's written that IL&FS continues to report comfortable asset quality indicators with nil gross and net NPAs as on March 31st.
Nil gross.
NPAs. Yeah. And maintains adequate general contingency provision 800 crore as on 31st March to protect its asset book from any unforeseen event. Uske baad they talk about stable cash flows in the form of dividend. Matlab, now they are praising the financials. Okay. Then adequate financial flexibility on the back of strong banking relationships and ability to raise debt from capital markets.
And how they were doing it, we all know now. Yes. Right?
Okay. So now they said this out here. And now look at the challenges. High leverage.
Exactly opposite. Right?
High leverage resulting from the sizable capital requirement across subsidiaries. Okay. Particularly considering the regulatory guidelines. So they are saying that leverage is high, but it's within the regulatory guidelines. Then ability to manage stake sales. Now, this is a very key thing actually in this case, where they actually make these projects and then they sell the projects off. So if they are not able to sell their projects off, this company is going to default. Okay. This, they have clearly mentioned here that the company's in line with the guidelines remains relatively illiquid, with large investments in group companies engaged in long gestation and capital intensive projects.
Correct, but type of project they were financing, that has to be there. Correct. The infrastructure projects they were financing, they are like that.
Yeah, they so like they are not, if they don't get an exit, this thing is bound to get stuck.
That's a fair challenge.
Yeah.
That's a fair challenge.
Yeah. So they have mentioned these two challenges, okay, and then about the company and all rosy things. And there's a last stanza here which says that, no, it's not there.
So here they have given everything, correct?
Yeah, so here they have given everything.
How they now, have raised money, correct? So, Janak, so guys, earlier we were talking about the GIFT project and all. We were talking about Island. So there are IL&FS Transport is there. Sister concerns are there, correct? IL&FS Transport
it
is there.
It has 300 plus subsidiaries.
Forget that. Done.
Every project, one subsidiary, paisa,
under. And here we are talking about IL&FS Finance, correct? Yeah. So the IL&FS Transport, everyone knew that this is a kachra company, correct? This is a dub, means that company has, if you see the stock prices, you would come to know that boss, the company to gaya, correct?
Yes, yes.
But people were backing on one company, one and only company, that is this one, the biggie one, IL&FS Finance, correct? And you are showing that credit rating to them, correct?
Yeah.
That credit rating reports. Okay, done.
So now, I'll show you the next report, okay? Now see how they change the language. In March, mein they gave a AAA wala rating or A1 rating. Okay, now that A1 wala bond got downgraded to A4 in September.
Okay.
On 8th September. Now, how do they change the language? Because we have written such rosy words in the start. Now we make it A4. A4 is like the least stable.
A4 size.
Right? So what do we do? So now they have said that, okay, are, so FATCA guidelines keep popping up.
September is a special month, correct? And everything started from September. And they got the whiff of it and they changed the report, correct?
Yeah, so they defaulted on their June installments in July. Okay, the grace period, all that got over in August,
correct,
where they defaulted. And in August, once I think ICRA also downgraded their some bond.
Yes, okay. August they downgraded after their auditor's report.
Yeah.
After the audit report. Okay.
Yeah, and in September here, they are downgrading again. Now see the how the language changed. Okay. The rating revision is driven by material weakening of the company's liquidity profile. Okay.
That means they are not paying the debt. That they are not paying the interest.
Yeah, but they are. Reality. Yeah, but they still go on to defend it that while ICRA has taken note of IL&FS plans of raising 8,000 crores through a mix of this, greater clarity is awaited on the timing of inflows. Okay, so now we know that they are going to raise 8,000 crores from somewhere, so we'll keep that in mind. But as of now, they are junk bond.
Correct.
Okay, but this is what they wrote out here.
But they are writing down here, but they are giving which rating still?
A4 is junk.
A4 is junk.
Yeah, this A4 is for short-term debt.
Short-term debt. Okay.
Done, yeah, done, so done. It's junk.
I was talking about long-term thing.
Okay. That comes on 18 September.
Perfect. Perfect.
That report also I've got. Now, check the key rating drivers again. Again, credit strength, group track record. Strategic importance to the overall IL&FS portfolio.
That
some new crap.
That is not a thing.
Yeah, and now credit challenges mein sab ek ek karke now they are putting deteriorating in credit profile of the parent company where they revise their bond. Risky wholesale lending model with high concentration in loan book. My question here is that did this risky wholesale lending model come after March?
No. It was there since ages.
Yeah, then why did it show up here in September?
And that too with figures.
Yeah.
That too with figures.
Matlab, this is the stupidity that, you know, these guys do and they get away with it.
Correct.
And nobody's going to question them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is deterioration in asset quality of the portfolio. So now we talk about the company's gross NPAs. March mein NPAs didn't matter. Now suddenly we got in.
But they mentioned that nil NPAs.
Yeah, now
nil
they are NPAs. Saying that March mein there were some NPAs, 3.3%, and now they are yeah.
So we need to look at annual reports for this. Correct.
Agreed.
Suddenly they are talking about all this.
Yeah, where did all this come from?
Correct.
Yeah, elevated debt levels. Again here. It was at 8.42 in March 2018.
6.56 times as on March 2007.
Yeah. And this now elevated debt levels, okay, is not showing in the March report.
Correct. That's yes. A very valid point.
Right.
Correct.
Yeah.
This is how they play with the words to give
so
the ratings.
They will show you some shit and they'll not show you some other shit. Now you see the September report. I just will take, I think, a couple of more minutes.
These are very important things.
Yeah. In 10 days, what happened?
In 10 days only. Correct?
In 10 days, this same bond, Joe.
This is the March 2008.
Oh, this is the wrong one. Wait, open the third one.
Which one?
The
which one?
Yeah,
1709.
Yeah, this one.
Because of the default?
Yeah.
The entire thing. Correct?
So, now this A4 wala jo bond hai, in 10 days, D ho gaya.
Ultimate junk.
Yeah, ultimate junk. Matlab, 10 days mein aisa kya ho gaya?
Agree.
Okay. So, now, why? Because they technically on paper, if a company strip from A1 bond to D bond without having reports in the middle, the company is going to get screwed.
Yes, there will the argument they always give that if we do that, then company loses their ability to raise and hence ability to be existent. That's why we do the stepwise thing and give company the
credit strength not applicable.
So now credit strength not applicable in 10 days. This is how bizarre your credit rating agencies are, people. And now if you're wondering why your markets are crashing, because these guys are rating your bonds. Oh, and fat ka comes in. Yeah. 10 days, what shit went down? Like, why couldn't this come out on 8 September?
And earlier also.
small SME company also.
Yeah.
छोटा मोटा जो business भी चला था ना उसका भी नहीं होगा working capital.
In 10 days, IL&FS anyways couldn't have done shit, man.
Just now, ICRA has rated down a debt of Jet Airways. I think it has from BB plus to B minus. Today itself.
Yeah. So today, guys, breaking news. Today, ICRA rated. Jet Airways bonds were downgraded from double B to single B.
And this is in matter of 30 days.
Yeah.
It has been downgraded in matter of 30 days.
Yeah. So maybe our next video might be on that. But okay.
Let's see. But Jet Airways celebrated that with from 170 to 205.
I know.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Anyways, so for that, it's
like an official roast of ICRA.
It's not a roast of ICRA, Saikiran. What happens from 9 to 3:30 is an actual official roast of our us investors.
Yes.
Understood.
And
so the guys might have seen the actual impact on the stock market from the DHFL fall. But if you see from the default of IL&FS, stock market was there at high, staying over there. It was not budging down. And that was the joke.
No, okay. I just wanted to bring one case. So, just one case. Like those are people are saying that DHFL fall. Do you remember how many times DHFL went into ban period in derivatives?
Yeah, well. Like if you remember.
Eternal ban.
So DHFL
knew some shit's going to go down.
So DHFL was in ban period for past 3 months on derivatives.
Definitely.
And being in a ban period, that means someone has taken an external over leverage position on its derivatives contract.
Correct. That means, explain them. That means.
That means someone knew that DHFL.
Something is coming. Apart from that, so what was this?
Forget DHFL. Infibeam was banned for 3 months.
Infibeam was banned for.
Check out when Nifty peaked.
Yeah, in the month of September.
And this fellow defaulted in like first week of August.
No. Everything happened the first time. Correct.
Yes.
Correct.
Yeah, IL&FS defaulted first week of August.
August, yes.
And the first ICRA downgrade also of IL&FS happened in first week of August.
That's the joke. Correct. That is the joke. Look at this. This is the August. Stock market was at 11,500. From there, stock market went to 11,750. That means, guys, that something huge is going on in your market. And stock market is not reflecting that. That doesn't mean that everybody is fool. That means smart money is making you fool.
We used to come every day on weekend. Are is bar market girega?
Yeah. Well, if you see our weekends, you'd come to know the other side of the story. Anyways, so proceeding. This was all about the IL&FS conundrum which took place. Okay. And I think now we should move on to the last part of our story.
That is
the spillover effect. So guys, we have spoken about the rise of these housing finance companies. Finance.
We've spoken about IL&FS, IL&FS.
In particular, okay, what has happened. What it does, what happened, and how things went.
Because everybody's blaming that IL&FS defaulted, so all the other NBFCs are like the result of that, and that is the reason we want to talk about IL&FS. And now the last part, which is
spillover.
Yes.
So the thing is, guys.
No, he was sitting like this.
Yes.
Yeah, he was thinking about the entire thing with a sad face.
Sad face. Yes, correct. Yeah.
He's in the investor mode right now.
Yeah. Okay. The spillover, correct? Yes. IL&FS, because of credit rating agencies, IL&FS, they got AAA rated bonds. Once you have AAA rated bonds, that means mutual funds, all other funds, they are these
especially
bonds
funds
are
like DSP BlackRock.
Anyone, all the funds, they are eligible to take those bonds into their funds. Correct? Because they have the norms also. Correct?
Okay.
Because
they have the norms also that, okay, we will only invest in AAA rated funds. Correct. Now you have IL&FS have AAA rated funds. Now everyone has that exposure. And because of that exposure, that is the starting point of debacle.
Correct.
Now, let's have a look at who all has the IL&FS
invested in these AAA bonds.
Let's look at that. So, and we are talking about IL&FS, okay? The issuer name, here entire thing is IL&FS.
IL&FS,
from,
yes.
From be it IL&FS finance, transportation, energy, education, everybody, okay? Have a look at this, guys, okay? These are coupons, okay? And schemes. If you see this, DSP, Aditya Birla, Kotak, okay?
Principal corporate.
Aditya Birla is there, UTI is there, Kotak is there, Tata Corporate is there, DSP. Have a look at that, DSP 1, 2.
And look at the percentage. 10,
DSP 3, DSP 4, okay? Correct? All these things were there. That means have a look at the amount of exposure these guys are taking from IL&FS. Why? Because they are AAA rated bonds. Now, the thing is, guys, you cannot blame these funds also. Correct. I'm not saying blame the fund manager. I'm saying blame these funds also because their mandate was AAA. Right. They got the AAA. Apart from that, they have to diversify. And all these corporate bonds or commercial papers, short-term commercial paper or long-term corporate bonds, they have good yield.
Yes.
Yeah.
You have good yield. You have to invest in that. Correct? Yeah. And at the higher level, main sambhal lega. Government is on my side.
Yes. Yes.
So everything is like that. Correct? And similar thing happened. What happened? DSP, you have seen DSP at various points over, correct? DSP here, DSP credit risk fund. What a joke.
Bolo.
Okay, but fund might be good. We are not going to comment on that. But it's right
just,
now,
it's just
bad.
Ironic.
Yeah,
it's just
right
ironic.
Now it's bad. So DSP has various, DSP's various fund has IL&FS exposure, correct? IL&FS defaulted in August.
August, yes.
Once IL&FS defaulted in August, now the smart money who knew that boss, this is something terribly wrong. Okay, those who have exposure in DSP's fund, they started redeeming.
Correct.
They started asking for money. Boss, I want exit. I want money, my money back. Once DSP BlackRock comes under that redemption pressure that they have to give money. So guys, again, think about this. All these funds, they do not keep their money idle for a long time. Whenever there is opportunity, they will invest.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
And once you have sudden redemption, huge amount of redemption pressure, that means you have to liquidate your assets or your investments.
Correct. Where are they going to pay them back from?
So they, correct. What Rahul was trying to say is, like, if DSP is coming and it's asking for its fund,
not DSP.
No.
I'm talking about like
if an investor is coming to DSP,
yes,
and asking
corporate
for,
and we are not talking about retail investors, because retail investors were enjoying the ride of Nifty from 11,005 to 11,750. They were dreaming and sleeping. Correct. The corporate ones.
13,000
Raja ka main bolta hun. Correct. The corporate guys, they were smart and they were making early moves, exits. And that's why they went to DSP. Boss, give me my money back. I want exit.
And also another angle is that if you have invested your crores of rupees in AAA bonds.
Correct.
And if one such bond defaults, don't you lose faith in the entire system of these bonds?
Correct. Especially corporate guys.
Yeah. Because that is what is happening. Right now, the market is absolutely risk averse.
Yes, right.
Nobody
now
wants to buy.
That's
like
it. That's it.
On 31st August, you had buyers for Nifty at 10,750, 11,750. And today on 4th October, we are on 10,550 and no one's willing to buy it.
So today, Nifty didn't give the ups. Only once Nifty give upside of 50 points,
that's
it.
That's it. Nobody was willing to buy the Nifty.
I think only,
people were scared shit.
Business channels were willing to buy.
On the business channel, they were talking about if we see 15, 20 year cycle, this is not a downfall. They were talking about like
one guy went on to say that this is not a bear market.
Okay, no problem. That's there. So our US government is coming and disrupting us through FATCA. So no problem. What happened? Again, let's come back to the story. So DSP is under redemption pressure. They want liquidity. They has to liquidate something. Okay. They has to liquidate something. Now they had two options. Okay. They had two options. One.
Either sell government securities
or sell their
corporate bond.
DHFL ka corporate bond.
Because no one was willing to buy IL&FS. Which they held in their portfolio.
So if
Yes, correct.
The fund manager Bakaida said that I could either sell GSEC or I could sell DHFL or IL&FS.
So IL&FS.
No one wanted to buy IL&FS, so I'll sell DHFL.
So who is going to buy the company who defaulted last month, correct? That's
yeah,
why.
Yeah.
Correct. So the requirement was 300 crore. This is official statement. Okay. 300 crore requirement was there. Now, coupon was 9.1. At that day, their mark-to-market yield was at 10.25 portfolio yield.
Right.
Bid was 10.5, ask was 11. There was 50 bips spread on that day. And they executed 300 crore at 11. And I'm not here to calculate that, how much is the loss for DSP. The thing is, have a look at their sentiments.
Right. They are willing to get out at any price.
Anyhow.
Their 50 basis point is huge.
Huge. And they were like, our loss was less than 65 bips. That's why we were ready. Right. But the point is not that. The point is, that means that corporate guy who wants to redeem, he was not ready to stand for a single day even.
Yes.
He was like, just give me my money back, that's it.
Oh, but that's the mandate of these funds.
But the thing is, in the normal circumstances, okay,
the manager
would have done it differently. Right.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, I have my doubts on the actual official story also, which they are citing.
In what sense?
They are saying that we want to sell 300 crores and that's why we are to sell DHFL bonds at 11%.
Correct.
But what if they actually knew that some shit is going to go down in DHFL?
Right.
Because after that, there were a few numbers which were published about DHFL's asset liability mismatches and all that stuff, buckets of DHFL over the last 6 months, etc., which are pretty scary compared to any other NBFC also.
Yeah, but Janak, this thing can be perfectly legit.
Yeah,
what
it's
you
an
are
alternative
saying,
theory.
Yeah, yeah. It can be perfectly legit and it can happen. Because otherwise, things would have so good, DHFL wouldn't be there below 300 even today.
Yes.
It should have given some bounce.
Yes.
It should have given some bounce. There has to be some fractured lines in DHFL also. Right.
No,
apart from that, there is
They were saying that there is a panic selling in DHFL, and because of that, there is a fall in of 50% in one day. So there has to be some recovery.
Correct. If things would have so good, there are things are not good, and that's why your
also,
theory might be correct.
Yeah, and also people are getting risk averse. Now, who will take the risk?
No one will take this.
Yeah, will
no
you buy
will
DHFL at 300?
No,
it's scary.
Correct.
No, the only people who are mentioning are.
Yeah, you have that chappan ki chhati and shit to go buy it. Yeah. But
if I'm an investor,
I'm scared of my capital.
And finally, all this point, if a single 300 crores order, if that is creating huge amount of ruckus in your bond market, that means your bond market is not liquid. Everybody knew that. But
right,
the problem was right now that because of that single sell, the yield shoot up to 11%. Yeah. That means next time DHFL, if they have to raise money, they have to raise at 11%. And that's the death. Because these guys, their business is on net interest margin. correct? And if you are going to borrow at 11%, your business is done. Once one such NBFC has yield at 11%, the similar kind of bonds, all the bonds, they will have yield at 11%. That means now from a single company, it became the problem of entire sector.
And NBFCs require fund. They cannot come up with the next debt with lower than this yield.
Correct.
They have to come up with a higher yield because current market yield is 11%. So that will also create a problem for the net interest margins, which they are currently. Patka is like.
And from a bond buyer's perspective also, I will ask for that much discount.
Yes. And now suddenly what happened? Now there is a second part of a story. Okay. Once DSP blocker, DSP sold the bond at 11, people were like, is there something bad? Once yield at 11, people were like, how in future they are going to earn? And is there something bad? And people were started dumping DHFL stocks.
Correct.
Once people started dumping DHFL stocks, there was a huge pressure and DHFL was down 50% at that time. After looking at DHFL and liquidity situation in the market, other NBFCs started going down. Once other NBFCs started going down, people, it went into financial companies. Once it is in financial companies, it went into all the stock market.
Our market is based on financial companies. If they are following, our market will follow pursuit every time. So that is something which has always happened because our markets are run by financial institutions. So that followed and every other company, and you can see what has happened in Nifty as of now today also. The selling pressure is still continued.
And now suddenly, just because of one, not just because of one thing, since it got exaggerated because of one event, now people are started looking at all other problems in NBFCs.
The
biggest of them for any banks or NBFCs is asset liability mismatch. Correct? That is the biggest thing over there. Because, guys, if everyone goes to NBFC or banks, at a single point or at any point, if everybody goes to bank and wants their money back, banks are going to default.
Correct.
That's for sure. Because they create credit, correct? On 1 rupee, they create credit of 10 rupees.
10 rupees, yeah.
Correct? So
1 rupee of capital.
1 rupee of capital, they create credit of 10 rupees. So there is no question that they can default any point if everybody goes together.
If there's a run on the bank.
Yeah. If there is run in the bank. So we don't do that, and that's why they have to keep balance of asset and liabilities, correct? Now have a look at this, guys. Okay, have a look at this. This is about percentage of total liabilities maturing in less than 6 months, percentage of asset maturing in less than six months. Correct? Here, have a look at Canfin Homes. 18.6
and
4.9. That means in less than 6 months, they have to give 18.6% of their thing, but only 4.9% of their loans, they're going to get recovered. And that's a huge problem.
Can we see the chart?
Yeah, but that's done now. Devan Housing.
Concert chart, bacha.
16.7 is to 10.9.
Devan Housing is, by the way, DHFL.
Devan Housing is DHFL. Okay, for people. Okay. Yeah. So have a look at this. Gruha Finance, 7.4 to 3. India Bulls, surprisingly, it's good.
Good, yeah.
Correct. Have a look at Repco Home Finance, guys. 30 to 3. There is a huge asset liability mismatch going on in NBFCs. Now, having said that, guys, at the bad time, people will talk about bad things. Every nooks and corners they will find and they will talk about bad. Then they will exaggerate. The thing is, in Indian NBFC space, asset liability mismatch was always there, is always there, it will be there. But the thing is, now, earlier people were filling up that gap with short-term loans. Now nobody is ready to give them short-term loans. And that's why asset liability mismatch is going to create a ruckus in the entire industry. Their business and business projections, they are going to get hampered because there will be no liquidity for them to lend. Nobody is willing to give them at lower rates. As it is, Indian bond yield is above 8.
8.1.
Correct. Their bond yield is at 11. Tell me, who is going to give them below that?
Right.
Correct. That's the problem right now.
So then financials also going to get messed up.
Because their net interest margin is going to reduce.
And that's why people are discounting the next 2-3 quarters. And we are not, again, we are not saying these are everlasting situations. Guys, this is all up. Okay, we will talk about the conclusion at the end.
Another way out is, other than taking short-term loan, is capital infusion by the parent company.
Who is the parent, dude?
So, HDFC.
Yes.
So, that is another option. But again, it's questionable whether the parent capital infusion takes place with dilution of shares or by issuing rights issue and all that stuff. So again, for shareholders, it's a bad thing only.
And it is hampering your entire thing. At the end, impact on price is there, correct? And now, if you're a parent, will you infuse in the time of chaos, or you will allow it to settle down and then you will start infusing the thing and showing the that depends on your existential crisis. Yeah, if you are going to go down, you have to do it right now.
Yeah.
But that's not a problem with few NBFCs. For a lot of NBFCs, okay, let me show you. So earlier we showed you the loan books, guys. HDFC, un log ne itne decades mehnat kiya, and they are at 4 lakh 1.
Correct.
Now these guys are there since last 5-7 years, and they are building a books of 1 lakh crore.
Yes.
Yeah. It's a huge thing. They are growing at a rapid pace. They cannot handle it. And things like this, the chatka like this, these guys, they have to be stable. They have to somehow slow down themselves. Yes, they have to have reality. Market is giving them reality check right now.
Yeah, so Mr. Piramal actually came out with an interview where actually in August itself he had raised concern over the NBFC sector problems. And now he said in his interview that this will actually separate the big boys from the little boys.
Perfect. Yeah. Now, second problem was commercial paper. So earlier, we guys, the asset and liability mismatch with short-term loans. Short-term is commercial paper.
Commercial paper.
So have a look at this, guys. From January 2018 to September, have a look at number. Source, the commercial paper, the source of filling up the gap.
Okay.
So have a look at that. After the default, nobody is ready to buy commercial papers. Have a look at this.
See,
580 issues, 814 issues in August. At the time of default, everybody was buying. But now nobody is willing
to. Look at the amount, 28,470
crore. And you're in lakhs. And this is the proof nobody's willing to lend. Now at this point,
this is the offer.
This is cumulative. Okay. Now, guys, at this point comes the very interesting pointer. And that interesting pointer is mutual funds. Okay. So in the last few years, mutual fund, they have a headache.
Correct.
They didn't got this much amount in their entire history.
Yes. So
thanks to demonetization. Everybody.
And advertising.
Yes.
So they are getting a lot of money from the market.
Correct. And.
Tera paisa bank mein kya kar raha
hai? Because mutual fund sahi hai. Mutual fund mein dalenge hum. So all these mutual funds, they got money. Okay. They got money up, like NBFCs. This is a euphoric time for mutual funds. Okay, last 2 years I'm talking about.
Since demonetization, people were like, mutual fund mein paisa dalne ka.
Now they are getting huge amount of money. They don't know what to do. And not like they don't know, they are going mad.
Yes.
Where to put in?
You know, so they used to push the Nifty higher because of that.
Yes,
but buy stocks.
But
they didn't even want to look for big other stocks.
Now, in the debt market, they have a look at this. In the debt market, 18% of their money. In the entire mutual funds money in the debt market, 18% is in NBFC, 13% is in housing finance. In totality, they have 31% exposure to NBFCs and housing finance companies. And I'm talking about their bonds.
Yes.
And once their bond is at 11% yield, okay, guys, and once their bond is facing this problem of defaults, Correct. And that's why shiver and jitters went into mutual fund companies.
Correct.
That's why mutual fund companies are like, okay, we are in problem right now. But
इसके लिए तो आए थे आज अपने
फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर. Yes. Have a look at this. Equity mutual funds came with the highest exposure to NBFCs. This is the list where Aditya Birla banking and financial 41% in NBFCs. Just go and look at its NAV right now. Correct. So mutual fund industries in the both way debt and this thing, they are exposed to NBFCs and therefore mutual fund things are scared. They are scared shit right now.
They have to be exposed, Rahul. Otherwise, they cannot invest everything in government bonds, right?
Agreed. But the thing is,
But then this is the result.
So in June, I was talking to someone, and in June, 60,000 crore rupees went in mutual funds.
Wow.
Okay, in June alone. So, yeah.
What to do with that now?
Yeah, so I was just talking to someone, and that person said, I think the next scam is going to happen in mutual funds.
But no, this is not a mutual fund scam.
This is not a scam, yeah. But
they are in a deep trouble.
Bubble trouble or something.
Yes. But and the point is, now again, mutual fund is not willing to lend.
Correct.
Because right now, if you go and talk to any market personal, he will tell you that everybody is sitting on cash.
Correct.
Whatever is left, everybody is sitting on cash. Nobody want to give out that cash.
So that is why
NBFC sell off.
The major reason is there is no liquidity right now in the market. Everybody is wanting to sit on cash, and that's if there is no liquidity, how will the market sustain?
Correct.
And that is why NBFCs fell,
and that's why, have a look at this. HDFC in January 5.5 price to book valuation, in January 18
6.7
current went down. Have a look at Diwan Housing BHFL 1.4.
It's still good.
And Grover Finance being the best over there, right? Still, it's 16.9. Because in NBFC space, everybody is going into that now.
Right.
Correct. So, and because
of... Bajaj Finance, I think it's good.
It is good right now. So, in entire... because of this entire episode, now NBFCs, they are facing the wrath. But the thing is, still, they are getting much better valuation than PSU banks. The question is then why they are getting the better valuations.
Are surviving.
Actually, even these guys will fight for survival.
But
maybe in few days they might not get better values than PSU banks.
But this will happen, Janak. Why people are giving them still better valuation? Because right now people are thinking like this is 2-3 quarters problem, and this is just a liquidity crunch. This is not asset quality problem.
Right.
Correct.
Right.
Once in these 3 quarters, if they get the liquidity, everything will subside. But they will not get earlier high time valuation unless and until they revive and give good business performance.
I want to remind all of you that tomorrow is the RBI policy.
Correct.
Yes.
Correct. RBI is in.
Today was finance ministry policy.
Just go and on YouTube, look at Arun Jaitley's whatever 10-minute speech. Mm-hmm. I never saw that guy so underconfident in my life. He's a good orator. He being a being from BJP, BJP has their upper cadre very well groomed and prepared for speeches. They are very good. But Arun Jaitley today, he was fumbling on English words.
I was discussing in one of our groups, WhatsApp group, like as he's speaking, market is falling. Nifty fell by 100, I think 70 points while his speech was going.
So what you said actually was also what the market felt.
Yes, definitely.
People see, market sees everything, boss. Correct. Market will see the body language of the finance minister more than what he's speaking.
So he was like, if I have to read this frothy valuation were long due for a correction, he was like, frothy valuations, and he was thinking something.
Yes. Sir.
And he was becoming a Ravi Shastri of this finance ministry. He was just repeating whatever was there in last 10 days, whatever happened in last 10 days. There were no solutions. So coming back to the point, hence NBFC sell-off happened, hence NBFC is at this valuations. People are thinking this is short-term thing. It will reside in 3 quarters. And that's why they are giving the valuation. Okay, this is not a long-term thing. But
plus one
to
more
give
thing.
That, okay.
LIC is the biggest DI, yes. Right? LIC
and here comes the government.
Government.
Here comes the government.
Here comes the pain.
Here comes the pain.
So LIC is the biggest DI in India. Okay, and who's bailing out IL&FS? Okay, so I want to raise a question over here. Like, if IL&FS is a company like this, does LIC common premiums should bail out company like IL&FS? It has already done with IDBI.
Correct.
Okay, IDBI, the worst performing PSU of all the PSUs, it is already done a merger with that. And now IL&FS is something which they are giving a bailout. There is already a 1,000 crore package by LIC to IL&FS for their
problems.
Yes, and now that the board has been changed, I want to raise a question, like, should really LIC bail out something like this? And it is the premium of our own, like,
so,
common people.
Yes, and the problem is that at this point, there is no option. Okay, at this point, why? Because we have seen 2008. Okay, if you look at deconstruct 2008, everything happened because of liquidity crunch at Lehman Brothers.
Right.
If somebody would have given that 1 year interest payment to Lehman Brothers, they would have been there. Correct. But everything started from liquidity crunch at Lehman Brothers. People or government right now is so fearful. One thing is election is there. One thing is also that they don't want to transfer this entire problem of NBFC sector to market first, then to interest rate,
to foreigners,
then to yields. And as it is, currency is depreciating.
That is what Jaitley spoke today.
Yes.
So
agreed.
Jaitley was like, "Arey, crude oil $90 kar chala gaya, hum kya kare?"
Yeah, Jaitley said that this problem which we are facing is our internal problem. It is not an international problem. So we want to solve it before it becomes an international problem.
So it will not become an international problem. It is the Indian problem, and it is going to be the Indian problem, but it is going to be very bad problem
if
they allow that thing to go out of hand.
IL&FS is a private company.
Agreed.
How can a private company be bailed out by LIC?
The thing is, on the moral grounds, it is your thing is correct. But the problem is not right now that. Problem is, in logo ne mutual fund sahi hai karke is pure India ka paisa debt fund debt and equity market mein laya. Correct. Now, if they don't bail out IL&FS, IL&FS ka bailout nahi hua, unka sara bond default to hui jayega. Apart from that, whatever corporate bond market they have created in last 3 years, it will go down, all 31% mutual fund exposure to that, all those funds will go down, redemption pressure will be there, and it will create an entire chain. And once that is there, sabka paisa problem mein aayega, and election pe problem hoga hi, but as it is, our dollar is at 74. Once dollar is at 70, so this will create entire stuff. This will create entire stuff. And that's why we don't have an option. Right?
Dollar 74 and Dow Jones falling.
Yes. So, bas, if government ko kuch karna tha na,
Okay, now can you hear us?
Yes, they can hear us.
It shows that the mic is showing.
Okay, can't hear you after that. Okay, you can hear us now because I can see.
Now we are audible. Okay. So your point.
Yeah. Yes. Your point is, if okay, the prima facie thing is entire thing. So we need to see the entire problem into perspective. There are two things. Okay, if you see the NBFC space, separate the NBFCs companies who have grown rapidly and they have done huge amount of expansion. Mm-hmm. Now they are unbalanced. Apart from that, you can bifurcate NBFC into based on asset liability thing. Okay. If you want to know which are under stress, those kind of companies who have wide asset liability mismatch and a huge amount of loan books without any balance, those companies will be under stress.
Correct.
Now, if I am the government, and government is doing that, they know that prima facie, this is a credit problem. Credit crunch problem, liquidity crunch problem. This is not a asset quality problem.
Correct.
Okay, so they are facing this, looking at this problem as a short term problem. Now that means they want government has to give them liquidity, and government is doing open market operations to infuse that liquidity.
Right.
Correct. That is this thing will help them, but at the same time,
disaster management.
But at the same time, we can see the consolidations of NBFCs.
But
that the imbalance NBFCs, the bigger NBFCs, they will gazump imbalance NBFCs, and will
so
right. There will be a consolidation for sure.
One point I want to raise is, if even our bonds are at very high yield,
correct?
Government bonds, G-Sec bonds. So if you're talking about OMOs, then that would have a pressure on yields as well.
Yeah,
they'll have to come up with a higher coupon rate.
The thing is, they are buying the bonds. Government is buying the bonds from the market and infusing the liquidity in the market.
Mm.
Now, is this will impact the government's earlier money raising plan,
right?
And it will impact the general market. It will impact the fiscal deficit and everything.
Correct.
But as it is, markets are going down, and everybody knows that it is going to go down.
Correct.
So, and it is a election year; only 3 months are left. So the making is for government is to किसी भी तरह से बचा लो. Other things are not on priority list right.
So
correct. So Janak, you wanted to say something in between. I stopped you. I guess.
Forgot.
Anything else, guys?
So anything else? If you want, we still don't feel as of now the markets are really good for investment. If you're thinking about investments, we don't still feel that it is the right time. You will come across lot of reports, right? Market has fallen. It's good time to invest. Keep on investing right now, but don't do it for right now. That is what we feel. There will be a time where market will clearly tell you that it is the right time to invest. Okay, that is a time. Till now, we do not see any purpose of long term investment as of now. And
anything else?
So Anit is saying that he read in the newspaper about how the government helped mutual funds on liquidity in 2013. So there was a debt crisis of sorts in 2013 too,
yes,
where RBI had actually a special window which they opened for banks to help out mutual funds for the bonds which banks actually purchased.
Can be there tomorrow also.
Yeah, so KK Mistry of HDFC Bank, he has asked the RBI to do it again.
Correct.
But
let's see tomorrow.
Yeah, let's see.
They will, if this is a short term thing, they will do the all possible things to infuse the liquidity. That's not the problem.
So is there any question that we can answer?
How does a bailout work exactly? Taxpayers' money is used to pay the debt, or do companies pay back the bailout money to the government in the future?
So in 2008, that didn't happen. In 2008, in US, that didn't happen. Correct.
So in bailout, what happens is that they actually buy the underlying bond and give money.
Correct.
Okay, they'll buy the bond at a cheaper rate. One would hope.
Right now, LIC is planning to give that 1,000
crore.
That is also a bailout. LIC is giving them
now.
Yeah. So
LIC is doing it because it's a shareholder over there.
Yes, correct. 100%
shareholder. Correct. And it will be looked at that LIC ka loan hoga ya fir zyada share aayenge.
Right,
that
right.
can be done.
Right.
But government bailouts didn't happen like that. That's a completely different story. Correct. They infuse money. They
correct.
Infuse money right out.
Right.
Correct.
Yes.
So, technically speaking, the person who holds the bond gets the money back once the bond face value expires, like once the bond matures. But so normally that happens where by the company issuing more bonds and paying back the old ones. So it's a never ending cycle. So iski topi uske sir kind of a situation.
Sometimes in the bailouts they completely own the company.
They restructure the bonds as well. They restructure the debt of the company. They might come up with a lower interest rate to. They might tell the debt investors who are there that we are lowering the interest.
So right now, what is happening that since last 8 years because of QE, this all the central banks they were buying bonds.
Correct.
वो कभी ना कभी मैच्योर होगा बट नाउ दे हैव अनाउंस्ड दैट इवन इफ आवर बॉन्ड्स गेट मैच्योर्ड वी विल नॉट आस्क यू मनी अंटिल द टाइम यू आर सेटल्ड करेक्टली सो देयर आर एन नंबर ऑफ ट्रांजैक्शंस बट ऑलवेज इट इज गोइंग टू बी अ ट्रांजैक्शन करेक्ट
इट हैज टू बी
एंड गाइस दिस इज शॉर्ट टर्म थिंग राइट नाउ इट इज गोइंग टू बी ट्रांजैक्शन बिटवीन बॉन्ड्स और stake or something else. It
correct.
Is not like default or a pura ka pura company.
Company
is going down. It is not like that.
Correct.
LIC is on there on the shareholding list of IL&FS. Wo log dal diya 1000.
Yeah, crore. But correct. If 4-5 such the default
then
happen,
it is going to be a different
then we
package.
Are looking at a completely different.
So system. Then there will be a special package for entire sector. And
so then it will be different. Like it won't be a 1% bailout. It will be different.
Different thing will be there.
So that's it. Like you
anything
have
anything else
to add?
So AIG got a bailout.
Yeah, everyone got a bailout over there. And bailout can be from different forms also. Government can find out any investor and ask him, boss, bailout kar do. It
so,
can be government money, private
so
money.
So RBI oil marketing companies, they have got ECBs. They can that has been deferred yesterday, but that has not any effect on our rupee. Rupee still making life high.
Mm.
Yeah. So yeah. Anything else? I think we've done for the day.
So
I
yeah, we have
enjoyed.
Done for the day. And hopefully we have done justice to this topic.
Okay.
Yeah.
Please let us know in your comment section that if you love, we will come up with more topics on this front. And that's it from our end. Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Bye.